We've looked at the building blocks for the origin of life and thought about some of the processes by which early life might have come to be. But another question is, where did this occur? Where did these early reactions occur? And where are plausible environments where the origin of life might have happened? Well, in order to answer that question or think about answering it, we first of all have to understand what we need for an origin of life. Quite apart from those building blocks, there are three other things that are necessary in order to get an origin of life. First of all, we need an energy source. We need energy to do those chemical reactions, to create those building blocks, and eventually to assemble those building blocks into more complex structures and eventually cells. We also need a means of concentrating molecules. In the absence of membranes, those early molecules that we need to assemble early membranes and other chemical reactions have to be able to be concentrated, otherwise they'll just dissipate in the environment. They'll become diluted in the oceans. So we need environments where complex chemicals can begin to concentrate. And finally, we need an environment that's conducive to these complex molecules and their assembly once they've been made. It's no good having an environment, for example, that's so hot that when we assemble membranes, they simply fall apart because of the intense heat. So we need to find environments where the physical and chemical conditions might be conducive to these molecules once we've made them. One of the earliest speculations about the origin of life was made by Charles Darwin, who in an 1871 letter to his friend Joseph Hooker wrote the following, and it's worth reading it out, it's rather a remarkable speculation. "But if, and oh, what a big if, we could conceive in some warm little pond, with all sorts of ammonia and phosphoric salts, light, heat, electricity, etc. present, that a protein compound was chemically formed, ready to undergo still more complex changes. At the present day, such matter would be instantly devoured or absorbed, which would not have been the case before living creatures were formed." Darwin's warm little pond has become rather an iconic image of where the origin of life might have occurred. It's certainly a good idea, but based on what we know about environments today on the Earth, can we come up with perhaps some more concrete speculations about what that warm little pond or what those environments might have looked like? Let's have a look at some of the environments where people think the origin of life could have occurred. One possible environment is deep sea vents. These are vents on the bottom of the oceans where reducing fluids, hot fluids, are gushing up from the crust of the Earth into the oceans. These fluids contain iron and sulfur, which is very interesting because in some of the energy transfer proteins in life, we find chemical compounds that contain iron and sulfur. And some people have speculated that these iron and sulfur complexes may be a remnant of early life on the Earth. Alkaline deep sea vents are thought to be particularly favourable places for the formation of chemical compounds. The source of energy in this environment comes from the hot fluids coming up from inside the crust. The concentration of organic compounds could potentially occur in the chimneys around these vents where they're gushing up into the oceans, in the rocks that are formed around the edges of these plumes of material that are being produced in the oceans. They may be conducive to the formation of complex compounds because the compounds could be dissipated into the oceans or collect around the vent where temperatures are cooler and where they wouldn't break apart so easily. So we can see that many of the requirements for the production of chemical compounds needed in the origin of life might have been met in these deep sea vents. Another possible location are impact craters. Asteroid and comet impacts onto the early Earth were much more common than impact vents today. And in these environments, they may have been places where early chemical compounds required for the origin of life could have formed. When an asteroid or comet slams into the surface of the Earth, several things happen. First of all, it heats up the rocks, providing a source of energy for chemical reactions. And secondly, that heat can create hydrothermal cells, in other words, circulating water through the impact crater. That circulating water could have provided environments for early chemical reactions to occur to produce complex compounds. And the water that collects inside that impact crater might be an almost literal interpretation of Darwin's warm little pond, a body of water heated by the energy that came from the impact and creating an environment where early chemical compounds could form inside the impact crater. As the impact crater cooled down, so conditions would become more conducive to complex chemical compounds to assemble and form inside the crater as temperatures became less extreme. So asteroid craters are yet another possible location for the formation of early compounds and their assembly into early life forms. Yet another environment that people have thought about are beaches. Beaches are interesting because, of course, as the tide comes and goes, water flows over the surface of rocks. And as the tide goes back out again, the water inside the rocks begins to evaporate, concentrating chemical compounds inside those rocks. So perhaps rocks on the edges of beaches were also places where early chemical compounds could have concentrated and early chemical reactions could have occurred to form the building blocks of life and ultimately more complex chemical compounds. A bit like the hydrothermal vents, yet another location could be volcanic hot springs on the early continental land masses instead of in the deep oceans, now on the continents. And the advantages of these early volcanic hot springs would have been much like the deep sea hydrothermal vents. Source of energy would have been hot fluids coming from volcanic regions in the crust and flowing onto the surface of the earth. Chemical compounds would have collected in these early volcanic hot springs. And as some of these hot springs began to cool down or circulated into regions that were cooler, there would have been conducive conditions for complex organic compounds, ultimately cellular material, to have formed in these hot springs. Here is another very interesting idea for how the early building blocks of life might have formed in bubbles. And the idea is that volcanoes erupted under the sea, releasing gases enclosed in bubbles. And these gases might have included hydrogen, methane, carbon monoxide, and other types of reactive gases. The gases concentrated inside the bubbles then reacted to produce simple organic compounds. These bubbles would rise to the surface of the ocean and burst, releasing their contents into the air. These simple chemical compounds, these simple organic compounds, would then drift through the atmosphere and react even further, perhaps with ultraviolet radiation in the atmosphere from sunlight, creating more complex organic compounds. And eventually, these complex organic compounds would have rained back into the ocean as raindrops and rejoined that process, again forming bubbles and being recirculated to the surface of the ocean and back out into the atmosphere. There's no direct evidence for this process as a way to form the early compounds required for life, but it's a very interesting alternative possibility for the production of early organic compounds. Of course, we've also seen that organic compounds could have been delivered from outer space in meteorites. So there are other possibilities other than some of the environments we've looked at on the early Earth. Yet another possibility is that all of these environments were reactors producing the early compounds required for life. Many scientists get very focused on one particular environment. It's not surprising. People do research on volcanic environments or impact craters or, for example, production of organics in early seawater. But it's quite possible that every one of these environments was generating organic compounds. Perhaps the whole of the early Earth was a giant prebiotic reactor producing chemical compounds in different environments that came together in one particular environment to produce early cells, an environment that we don't know the identity of yet, but early environments would have all been producing these early chemical reactions. Can we find any evidence in life for the environment in which it evolved? Is there anything about the biology of life that tells us where it might have evolved? Well, it's very interesting that some of the most primitive microorganisms, at least some of the most deep branching as we call them, microorganisms that seem to be the most ancient, are heat-loving microorganisms, thermophiles, literally heat lovers. And these microorganisms grow in volcanic vents and also in deep sea vents. And there may be some indication that the earliest life forms on Earth were actually heat-loving microbes that lived in hot environments. We have to be careful, though, because the early Earth was bombarded by asteroid and comet impacts, and because of volcanic activity, it was much hotter than it is today. So it might be that these ancient microorganisms that love heat represent some sort of bottleneck in evolution, microorganisms that were capable of surviving hot conditions on the early Earth, but not necessarily the earliest organisms that represent the earliest stages of life when it first evolved. But nevertheless, the fact that some of the most primitive organisms on the Earth seem to be heat-loving is rather intriguing. There are other more intriguing environments that are quite counterintuitive, where the early reactions for life on Earth might have occurred. And one possibility is in ice sheets. Water has an interesting property that when you freeze it, it tends to exclude salts that collect in boundaries between ice grains. Here you can see an image of some ice crystals and between them the boundaries where salts might collect. And in those boundary layers we might find concentrated chemical compounds where early reactions could have occurred. Of course, at low temperatures, chemical reactions occur much more slowly than at higher temperatures. But with many millions of years for these reactions to occur, maybe ice sheets on the early Earth were the places where early life could have evolved. Now, we have no evidence, of course, that early life evolved in ice sheets or the possibility that early chemical compounds would have formed in ice sheets, but it reminds us that we need to keep an open mind about the possibilities for the early origin of life. There may be some quite unusual environments that we think are not plausible locations for early chemistry, but might turn out to be important as places for early chemical reactions. So what have we learned in this lecture? Well, hopefully we've learned that numerous environments could have provided plausible locations for the production of the building blocks of life, and we've looked at some examples of those possible environments. We've learned that these environments need not be mutually exclusive, and different molecules might have been produced in different places. Indeed, the whole of the early Earth might have been a giant prebiotic reactor. And finally, we don't know how quickly this happened. Did the origin of life occur within a matter of days or weeks, or did it take hundreds of millions of years? This is one of the unsolved questions in the origin of life, and a question that astrobiologists still have to address.